Welcome to our virtual worship service here at St. John's Evangelical Lutheran Church, Perrysville. And it's a pleasure to have you join us in worship. In terms of announcements, I would like to say that next week, on the 13th of September, we will have in-person worship services here at St. John's at 9:15 on Sunday morning. You have to register first. You can do that with Sign Up Genius on our website or simply by calling the church office. And we will make sure that a place is reserved for you. If you would like to come to a special communion service, you may do so on Wednesday at 6 o'clock and 7 p.m. And those are the short little communion services that last about 15 minutes apiece. And also we will have opportunity for you to be here on Saturday at 1 o'clock and also at 2 p.m. So now let's prepare for worship. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot come to your side. We have seen things to have thought of word and deed, of what we have done, and of what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves.
For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us.
Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name.
Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord God, enliven and preserve your church with perpetual mercy. Without your help, we mortals fail. Remove far from us everything that is harmful, and lead us toward all that gives life and salvation. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Reading is from Ezekiel. Ezekiel was a prophet who lived prior to and during the Babylonian captivity. Ezekiel is a sentinel, a watchman, one who gives a warning, not necessarily about external forces, but warnings from actions within the Israeli community. Our passage from Ezekiel concludes with God asking the house of Israel, why would they choose to die when they can be alive and turn away from their wicked ways? A reading from the 33rd chapter of Ezekiel. So you, mortal, I have made a sentinel for the house of Israel. Whenever you hear a word from my mouth, you shall give them warning from me. If you say to the wicked, O wicked ones, you shall surely die, and you do not speak to warn the wicked to turn from their ways, the wicked shall die in their iniquity, but their blood I will require at your hand. But if you warn the wicked to turn from their ways, and they do not turn from their ways, the wicked shall die in your iniquity, but you will have saved your life. Now you, mortal, say to the house of Israel, thus you have said, our transgressions and our sins weigh upon us, and we waste away because of them. How then can we live? Say to them, as I live, says the Lord God, I have no pleasure in the death of the wicked, but that the wicked turn from their ways and live. Turn back from your evil ways. For why will you die, O house of Israel? The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Teach me, O Lord, the way of your statutes, and I shall keep it to the end.
Give me understanding, and I shall keep your teaching. I shall keep it with all my heart.
Lead me in the path of your commandments, for that is my desire.
Incline my heart to your decrees, and not to unjust gain.
Turn my eyes.
In our second reading, the obligation of Christians is to love one another and so fulfill the heart and goal of the law. Clothes make the person as we put on the Lord Jesus Christ and live today in light of the future God has in store for us. A reading from Paul's letter to the Romans, the 13th chapter. Owe no one anything except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word, love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. Besides this, you know what time it is, how it is now the moment for you to wake from sleep. For salvation is nearer to us now than when we became believers. The night is far gone. The day is near. Let us then lay aside the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us live honorably as in the day, not in reveling in drunkenness, not in debauchery and licentiousness, not in quarreling and jealousy. Instead, put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to gratify its desires. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 18th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus said, if another member of the church sins against you, go and point it out the fault when the two of you are alone. If the member listens to you, you have regained that one. But if you are not listened to, take one or two others along with you so that every word may be confirmed by the evidence of two or three witnesses. If the member refuses to listen to them, tell it to the church. And if the offender refuses to listen even to the church, let such a one of you be as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly I tell you, whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Again, truly I tell you, if two of you agree on earth about anything you ask, it will be done for you by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, I am there among them. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, O Christ.
Grace and mercy and peace from God the Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Wednesday afternoon, as it is my custom, I went across the street here to the farmer's market, which is the adjacent parking lot at St. John's Lutheran Church. And I want to let you just give you a brief word about that. They are going to continue on every Wednesday until the end of October. And there's lots of produce over there. But as I was going over there, I saw a member of our congregation who I haven't seen for a couple of weeks. And he was walking over there, and it was right after he probably left his home where he was working from home. And this man is in finance, and he was clothed in a t-shirt, a pair of shorts, and flip-flops. I couldn't help but tease him about that and say, office attire? And he actually explained to me, he said, no, Pastor, not quite. He said, I changed t-shirts into a fresh t-shirt. I had the other one on for like two straight days. You know, here in 2020, all the dress codes have gone out the door. But I must confess that most of the time, I kind of dress like him when I'm in the office here at St. John's. Prior to that, I would always be dressed in a jacket or a tie or a clerical collar, something that looked nice and presented myself as a professional, but not in this day of lockdown and social distancing. But it's odd how clothes have an effect on us, as the introduction to the second lesson said. Clothes, they used to say, make the man or the person. Clothes have an effect on us, and most of us realize this. You know, there's that one outfit that you love to wear. Maybe the color really looks good on you, or it fits perfectly. It hides your flaws, and it accentuates your strength. And so you just feel better whenever you have that. Or maybe if you do dress in a shirt and tie, you feel more professional than you would if you were in shorts and flip-flops. But they do have a profound effect on us. Witness even hundreds of years ago, those fairy tales that we all listen to about the magic hat, the magic coat, or their Cinderella's glass slippers. In Romans, we heard Paul say, put on the armor of light. And then again, toward the end of that lesson, he said, put on the Lord Jesus Christ. That word comes from an imagery about baptism in the early church, where people were baptized, were fully immersed, and then brought out of the water, and they were given a new garment to show that they had been clothed in the life, the death, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And this is one of the reasons why I wear a white robe. And most of the servers up at the altar, you know, the communion assistants and also the acolytes, they wear white robes to remind us that we are to be clothed in our Lord Jesus Christ. It comes back to that ancient liturgy. We're clothed in the mercy of Christ. Christ, and his life should have an effect on our attitude toward life, and it also should have an effect on the actions that we take as the people of God. We are dressed in a life of devotion of Christ that he gave to us as an example. And one of this first things is, I believe, the garment of prayer. We are to be people of prayer. Why? Because it says prayer changes things. I think it does. Primarily, prayer changes us. You know, there are a lot of things we want changed in the world, but we have to be honest that we ourselves are in need of correction and also of healing. But prayer is more than that. It's a great way of being unself, if you will, about taking your attention away from yourself, because true and honest prayer doesn't just simply give God a catalog of things that you would like to see happen, but rather is an acknowledgement that God is God and that we are not. And that model that Jesus gave us in the Lord's Prayer, the first requests are all about God and his kingdom. Our Father who art in heaven, first request, hallowed be your name. May your name be holy, because when your name is holy and when you are respected, we respect ourselves and we respect each other. And then, thy will be done. Not what we want, but your will. And then thy kingdom come. And then after that, we get along to what we need in life. Give us today our daily bread. But prayer is great for, as some people say, unselfing us as people. And so that we're not the focus and attention of our lives all the time, but rather our lives are centered on God and also our brothers and sisters. Another garment that we should be wearing is empathy. Listening. And in this broken world where there's so much conflict, I think listening is so important for us as the people of God. Before we speak, we should listen and hear what others say, especially those people who differ from us, those people who have a different experience and a different perspective on life. We are called to listen to what they have to say. Yes, God has all the answers, but we don't. That's for sure. And we have to broaden our horizons by engaging other people. First, by listening. Listening saves us from just simply reacting. Listening helps us to engage a person and then respond to what we hear them say. And then there is the garment of healing, something that Jesus did quite a bit. He was a healer. He went about healing the lame, the sick, and the blind, but also the brokenhearted and those who were guilty. He healed the broken relationships as well and gave us that ministry, as Paul says in the fifth chapter of 2 Corinthians, that ministry of reconciliation. We are called to be workers, to wear that garment of light into this dark world and work on the ministry of reconciliation. I remember this time of year as a youngster in terms of clothes. One of the things we always did was go out and shop for school clothes, something I despised because I really never did like going, the idea of going back to school. But anyway, we would get to our clothes and to make sure that we had everything that we need. You know, we'd have to go out and buy shoes and socks and pants because the ones from the previous year, well, they didn't fit us, we outgrew them. But our dress, our garment, we don't have to shop for it. That has been purchased for us in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. Jesus gives us the expectation of what we should be like in terms of his followers, and then gives us the power to fulfill that. I belong to a club, the German club downtown, the Teutonia, as it's called, and they have a strict dress code whenever they have big meetings, big dances and gatherings. The men have to wear a jacket and a top. That's a requirement. But something I think about in terms of baptism, and also in terms of the practice of the flock, if you're a man and you show up and you don't have a jacket and a tie on, they have a collection of ties and a collection of jackets. Yes, you might not make the cover of GQ wearing the tie and the jacket, but you will meet the expectation. I believe in baptism, we are given the ability to do what God has given us to do, to work in His kingdom, and to bring about understanding, reconciliation, and healing in this land. Whether we are home wearing our, or whether we are here wearing our Sunday best, let us always walk wearing the mantle of the love of God given to us by the Lord Jesus Himself. Amen. Let's confess our faith by using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
Drawn together in the compassion of God, We pray for our world, our church, and all those in need. We pray, O God, for leadership in our nation, buffeted by the pandemic, growing inequality, and heightened tensions among our citizens. Guide us to choose leaders who can work with people and organizations that can bring about that which is good for all of our citizens. Instill in our leaders the ability and the wisdom to heal. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray, dear God, for your guidance. Open our hearts and our minds to recognize that you are there. We just need to accept you into our lives. Lead us not to ask why something happened, but what we can do to help. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for the people of Lebanon who have suffered greatly from war and now from destruction in Beirut. Guide the efforts of world organizations to provide needed food and shelter to the Lebanese people. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You have shown your love for us, dear Lord, by giving us stewardship of your creation. Give us the wisdom and the discipline to protect, conserve, and to restore that which you have entrusted to us. Bring comfort and relief to those places suffering from drought, flood, pollution, especially those in Louisiana who have lost so much from the hurricane. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Dear Lord, we pray that you comfort all in need of your compassion. Hear the cries of those awaiting justice and those asking for forgiveness. Provide community to those among us who are lonely and yearn for compassion and companionship. Give shelter to those who are vulnerable in body, in mind, and in spirit, especially those experiencing depression and loneliness during the pandemic. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Dear Lord, we ask that you sustain us in our work and give work to those who need it. Help us to love our neighbors in and through our work. Inspire us to use our abilities, our voices, our minds to work for the fair treatment of all who labor. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Almighty God, you're the healer of every ill. We lift up all those in our community who are hurting and need your hand of healing placed upon them. Especially we pray for Bill, for Linda, Josephine, Red. We pray for Joanna, Dylan, Tom, Donna, and all those that we mentioned in our hearts at this time to you. Grant them wholeness and peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We remember with thanksgiving those who have gone before us in the faith. Give us the ability to pass on to our children what those who have gone before us gave to us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. All these things and whatever else you see that we need, we entrust to your mercy through Christ our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and our power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen. Amen.
Go in peace, serve the Lord.